Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hellscape, a post-apocalyptic lit RPG by Jared Mandani. Narrated by Todd McLaren. Prologue. Insubordination. The angry clamoring of the crowd reached Nathaniel's ears, and if it weren't because of the kinetic shields held by the cadre of defense magi, bottles, rocks, tools, and other missiles would have already reached him. He frowned, watching the scene from his vantage point. Intel had said that the rebels were heavily armed, highly violent, and dangerous.
These are just farmers and workers, emaciated people asking, begging, for more than scraps for their families.
Among the crowd, easily seen through the enchantments in his helmet, he didn't spot anger or malice against the realm. He saw despair, hopelessness, and hunger. "This is wrong," he mumbled.
"What was that, Major Ratkovich?"
"Colonel, sir," Nathaniel answered. "I said, this is wrong. This is not a rebellion. This is a group of angry, hungry farmers." Colonel Ulyanov scoffed.
"Farmers. A fancy word for calling human refuse. Look at them, Ratkovich. What do you see? You see glorified slaves, that's what."
"Sir, with all due respect, said glorified slaves are the backbone of the realm's well-being. If we kill these,
more will sprout as if by magic, Major. They breed like rabbits. Kill one, and 10 take their place in under a year. Besides, making an example of these rebels would send a message. Stay in line," Ulyanov growled. "Keep your heads bowed, and don't bite the hand that feeds you."
"They don't look quite fed to me," said Nathaniel, before hastily adding, "Sir."
"Peace on what they look like to you. To me, they look like rebels, insurrectionists who dare raise their arms against their benefactors, nothing more."
"Sir, they are unarmed. They have sticks, tools, and coarse language. What chance do they stand against us?"
"None. Which makes them not only rebels, but also stupid and suicidal."
"They're seeking to feed their families, sir. They don't want to topple our government. They don't want to seize the means of production. They want food."
"Then they can eat their dead for as much as I care."
As Ulyanov spoke, a bottle shattered against the shield, erupting into a flaming blaze, which slid harmlessly down the arcane barrier, sending ripples along its surface.
"There are your unarmed farmers, Ratkovich. If it weren't for our defenses and their magics, we'd be grilling right about now.
Sir, we can't simply kill the population of an entire community. We should engage in diplomatic talks, offer them promises, assurances that they'll be able to provide for their families."
"We'll do no such thing, Major. We'll treat these things as what they are. Scum. Rebels."
He chuckled.
"Expendable."
Colonel Ulyanov rummaged through his heavy overcoat's pockets and produced a thick cigar. He flicked his finger, and a small flame appeared above his thumb. He lit the cigar and puffed at it, releasing a large cloud of tobacco smoke.
"Give the order, Major."
"The order, sir?"
"Are you deaf and daft? Do you see that crowd over there?"
Nathaniel nodded.
"Well, I don't want to. I want all of those insurrects dead or dying within the hour,"
Ulyanov said, turning to walk away, his heavy coat rustling with every step he took. Nathaniel followed Ulyanov's path with his eyes. He cast a glance over his shoulder at the mob and saw as one of the privates stationed at the bottom of the fortress rammed the butt of his halberd against the face of a man, caving it in.
"Gods above. Sir, are you insane? They're civilians.
Ulyanov stopped and turned around, flicking away the rest of his cigar.
What did you just say?
I said you can't order us to kill civilians. Such an act goes against everything we represent. You can't just...
Listen, Ratkovich,
Ulyanov said, stepping up to Nathaniel. The colonel inflated his chest, trying to make himself more threatening than he truly was.
I don't like your attitude. I've never liked it. But this is going one step too far. You're bordering on insubordination, boy. Yet I'll assume I misheard what you said. For your sake. I misheard, didn't I?
Nathaniel's eyes narrowed as he quietly stared at his superior.
Yes, sir. Good, then. Give the order. Have this scum exterminated.
Nathaniel watched Ulyanov as he walked away.
We're supposed to protect these people, not slaughter them as cattle, he thought,
feeling outrage welling inside of him. The clamoring of the crowd grew louder, and the projectiles they launched at the fortress increased in number. And yet, he could not, would not, wantonly kill civilians merely because they demanded food for their families. Nathaniel started walking purposefully towards the colonel.
Sir,
he called once he was within reach.
Gods above, what the fuck do you want now, you...
Nathaniel's gauntleted fist crashed against Ulyanov's face, sending him backwards in a spray of blood and broken teeth. The soldiers on the parapet reacted quickly, subduing Nathaniel, toppling him, and raining blows and kicks down on him. He didn't resist. He had no reason to. Ulyanov was the officer in charge of the peacekeeping detachment, and Ratkovich was his junior. With the two of them gone, the next link in the chain of command would lack the foresight to carry out Ulyanov's orders. It may be a momentary victory, but at least tonight, the farmers would go back to their families.
Only to share in on their misery,
Nathaniel thought bitterly. He was rolled on his back, and the butt of a halberd clashed against his face, turning the world to blackness. Chapter 1. Drachenstein.
Peace through superior technology. Technology through superior magic. Magic through superior knowledge. Knowledge towards superiority.
Motto of the Research and Exploration Brigades. The wheels of the cart rolled languidly over the snowy, rocky road. Not even the mid-afternoon sun could defeat the cold of the Clouds Reach mountains, and Nathaniel pulled his fur cloak tighter around his shoulders, trying to conserve what little heat he could. The driver of the cart seemed to notice him move, and in a thick, northern accent said,
"You'll get used to it soon."
Nathaniel smiled, though the driver couldn't see him, and said, "Can't be soon enough."
"Aye. You's a Southron, yes?"
"I am."
"You Southrons come up here for punishment only. Why are you here for?"
"Count yourself lucky, Ratkovich. Getting demoted and sent to the armpit of the world rather than a common grave is far better than you deserve."
Nathaniel scoffed. "I punched someone in the face."
"That don't seem like too much."
"Someone important," Nathaniel added.
"Ah,"
the driver said curtly. The simplicity of the man's expression caused a wan smile to rise on Nathaniel's face.
"He's a simple man, a man without worries, without concerns over the games of power and influence in the realm."
He lifted his gaze as the silhouette of a bird obscured the sun above. A large bird flew overhead, unconstrained by gravity or concerns.
"I envy him."
"You's a military man, ain't you?"
"Ah, yes. Why?"
Just asking. Yous large, bulky, like the others. But yous don't look mean-spirited.
Mean-spirited? Nathaniel asked.
Aye. Them's like to beat us up just 'cause. Take our foodstuffs. Take our daughters and waifs.
Nathaniel winced. The militia has been growing callous of late.
He blinked rapidly and scoffed.
Of late? Like I would know what things are like after 3 years in the can.
He sighed and said,
That's barbarous. We're supposed to protect citizens of the realm, not abuse them.
We's no citizens, the man said.
Nathaniel shook his head.
Though he deeply disliked the status quo, fact remained that Vitherness didn't recognize the territories at the outskirts as part of the realm. This man, his family, and anyone living nearby were little more than glorified slaves,
just as it was in Ruthfern 3 years ago.
The events at Ruthfern made his name a thing of infamy. The major who struck a colonel, the gold-hearted traitor, and, most often than not, the stupid bastard who pissed away his career. As he had done many times during the months prior to his trial, he wondered, if he were back at the parapet at the fortress in Ruthfern, crude projectiles barely stopped by a magic barrier, if Colonel Ulyanov ordered him to slaughter the populace, would he do it?
Yous have any family, my lord? Good man like yous must have.
A smirk formed on Nathaniel's lips.
Yes, I would strike the son of a bitch all over again.
Alas, I have no family. I'm an orphan. And being a good man,
he chuckled.
You may misjudge me, Mr. Randall, my lord. I ain't misjudging you. You's a good man, I can tell. And I's never been wrong before.
Thanks, said Nathaniel.
Though this may be the first time,
he thought, reflecting on himself. He had done bad things, terrible things on behalf of the realm, always for the purported greater good.
But Ruthfern was the last straw. Armed insurrectionists, dissidents, bandits, and brigands, those can die by my blade. Civilians, emaciated ones at that? That goes against everything we're supposed to represent.
How long until we reach Drachenstein? Asked Nathaniel,
eager to silence his thoughts.
Not much, my lord. Village is just above that hill over there. But ain't you headed for the castle?
Eventually, Nathaniel replied. First, I must be processed at the gatehouse. They must make sure I have the proper clearance before I can do so much as farting at the castle's general direction.
Ah.
Randall said nothing for a couple minutes, but Nathaniel could see him tilting and shaking his head occasionally.
He must be processing what I said.
If you's not who you said, they's taken you into Drachenstein, and you's not coming out, aye?
Taken into Castle Drachenstein?
The thought gave Nathaniel a bad feeling. Suddenly he felt a deep chill within himself that had nothing to do with the cold outside.
Why'd they take me in?
Randall shrugged.
I don't know, my lord, but one hears rumors, one does. And one hears the sounds at night.
Rumors and sounds? Nathaniel asked, his curiosity piqued.
Aye,
answered Randall. Nathaniel saw him make a sign to ward off evil, but the man said nothing more. Silence lingered heavily, ominously, as neither said anything.
Sounds and rumors,
Nathaniel scoffed,
as if Drachenstein's reputation wasn't grim enough already.
The carriage angled slightly upwards as it began the ascent up the hill Randall pointed at. Randall loosened his shoulders and neck before yawning loudly.
Must be routine to him by now.
The only village close to Drachenstein was Bergsende, half a day of travel to the south. Few people made the trip between Bergsende and Drachenstein. Randall was, in fact, commissioned by the militia command at Castle Drachenstein to bring Nathaniel to his new forever home.
A home away from all civilization,
he thought bitterly, as he contemplated a future of snow, cold, and the dreary presence of Castle Drachenstein in the distance. Being dispatched to the northern reaches was considered by many to be worse than capital punishment.
At least when you're dead, you don't care if your ass freezes over, they would argue.
The ruling elite of Vithernas wanted to paint a magnanimous, even pious image to its neighboring realms, especially those with trading arrangements with the crown. Though the realm tried to present itself as a civilian state, in truth, it was a militaristic magocracy, where power was the one true currency.
But appearances matter, Nathaniel thought derisively. Can't let trade partners learn about the cost of power, can we?
Still, everything he knew about this place was from the rumors spouted by his fellow military men. The thoughts of the locals would be more insightful.
Say, Randall, what can you tell me about Drachenstein and the village around it? Well, you know it's the place's old name.
Consider me ignorant, please.
Aye, my lord. The castle's old name. Grosses Schloss on Drachenstein. It means Great Castle at the Dragon's Stone.
Nathaniel chuckled. I think I like Drachenstein better. What about the locals? The environs? He paused.
Ah, to hell with it. No risk, no gain.
The rumors?
The locals be workers and soldiers, my lord. The first mine the mines and work the small farms at the caves. The others, well, they're supposed to keep the peace and stay at the castle.
The mines?
Aye, my lord. Under Castle Drachenstein, they's the ones that produce them crystals.
Crystals? Nathaniel asked.
They's called them taurolites, my lord, because they look like a bull's horns. We's called them different, though.
What do you call them?
Hellrunes, Randall answered.
Nathaniel scoffed. That's lovely. What do they use them for?
At the castle?
He shrugged.
Dunno, my lord. They pays us in them, they do. To purchase food, tools, everything.
Nathaniel frowned. They don't use standard copper, silver, and gold?
Them's worth nothing here, my lord. Only runes.
He shook his head, unable to believe his ears.
Damn mages, thinking themselves superior.
Dunno about the mages, my lord. They stay at the castle, they do. Don't come out much, they don't. That's why the rumors.
Right, said Nathaniel. About those rumors?
My lord, I's afeard of speaking it out loud.
Why is that?
Them's at Drachenstein don't like us speaking of them. They says they's forbidden, they do.
Oh, a dirty secret, perhaps?
Have they told you why they're supposed to be forbidden?
You should know, my lord. You're a military.
That's debatable, said Nathaniel. I've been demoted.
'Cause you hit someone important?
Aye. Randall chuckled under his breath.
They's deserved it?
They did.
Good,
Randall said.
Them's rumors, maybe that. Rumors. We's don't know. We's don't want to know. The nights, there's sounds from Drachenstein. Horrible howls. We thought's them from brigands and takens, but they's not. No human could make those sounds.
Just as I said before, damn spellcasters.
You mentioned brigands and prisoners?
Aye, my lord. Brigands. Them's we understands. They're gonna be executed. But takens,
he sighed.
Those be wrong, they be. But times, they's take our youth or nothing. We's never seen them again.
I see. He sighed, disliking his assignment more by the minute. But they're just rumors, as you said? Randall chuckled.
Aye, my lord. There's rumors, all right.
Rule number one of the militia,
Nathaniel thought as they neared the hill's crest.
Don't ask too many questions. Ironic, considering the realm purports that knowledge is power.
His curiosity was satiated for the time being. Nathaniel had disliked the resolution of being sent to Drachenstein to live out his days as part of the token forces of the castle. He had no need for rumors or legends to make his situation worse.
We be here, my lord,
Randall said as they crested the hill.
Castle Drachenstein.
Nathaniel stared, but only saw mountains. That can't be...
Gods above!
He gasped as he realized he wasn't looking at the peaks of Cloud's Reach anymore, but at the sheer, impregnable walls of Castle Drachenstein, looming ominously in the distance. The tremendous structures were hewn into the mountain range to form impregnable ramparts which towered high into the sky, its parapets dominating the view, forming an impassable bulwark of slate-colored granite. Its towers climbed beyond the clouds, their tops lost in the distance. The more he stared at the impossibly large castle which watched over the comparatively tiny village, the more he lent credence to the rumors whispered amongst military men. The castle hadn't been built by humans, but by something else. Something ancient. Something not of this world. Almost as soon as they crested the hill, their descent into Drachenstein began. The grim silhouette of the castle dominated the skyline and sent shivers down his spine.
Oh well, he reasoned. How long could the rest of my life be, anyways?
Chapter 2. Anomaly.
Officially, the new type of energy discovered in Drachenstein is named after its discoverer, Magus Erwin von Helmut, and that's the way it should stay. The unofficial name might stir awkward questions, the type of questions we wouldn't like our trading partners to ask, the type of question that would cause someone, an interviewer, for example, to have a tragic accident.
Lieutenant Armin Voorhees in Helmet Energy, an interview. Sorceress Daria Eisenhertz yawned as she poured warm coffee into her mug. She drank deeply, savoring the bitter liquid inside and hoping it would finally bring her to full wakefulness. A silly hope, considering that was her sixth cup of the morning, and the day had barely started. Despite her exhaustion after a full night of preparations reading dials, adjusting valves, changing arcane batteries, and drilling spellcasters on the proper incantations to use, she smiled.
Today is the day,
she thought, as she took another sip from her mug.
Today we activate the core.
She inhaled sharply and exhaled just as loudly.
Today begins a new era for mankind.
Years of work would culminate in her life's greatest achievement. A lifetime of dedication, sacrifice, and loss, all in the name of the greater good. At last, Vethernos would have an unlimited supply of power. Wars would no longer be waged for petrol and coal. Hunger would be abolished, and the de facto slavery of the outlying dominions of the realm would come to an end.
Must you consume gallons of that awful drink, sorceress?
A raspy voice asked beside her. Daria sighed.
I must, Evan. if I am to be at peak performance for the day's proceedings.
Erwin von Helmut scoffed, and Daria turned to stare at him. His bulging eyes glared at her from his emaciated, skull-like face, an effect exacerbated by his balding head.
I have told you. I'd prefer if you called me Magus. And I've told you, she said, drinking another sip. I don't care. Are preparations ready to commence the procedure?
Helmut shrugged, causing the steam rig supporting his body to hiss.
As ready as they'll ever be, considering the rabble we have to work with. And what is that supposed to mean? Only that sometimes I question the competence of some of our members, is all. Excuse me, sorceress, but there are matters I must attend to.
He bowed half-heartedly and walked away, his rig whistling with every step he took. Daria scoffed and finished her coffee.
Hypocritical, self-aggrandizing prick, she thought bitterly. He gets all the accolades. There's none of the effort.
Though she knew there was nothing she could do about it, the fact that von Helmut's name would be credited for the discovery of the new form of energy bothered her endlessly. She had learned to accept and live with the fact that her name would fade into obscurity, not because of a lack of competence, as von Helmut suggested, or because she hadn't contributed to the discovery, her discovery, in fact. The truth was far more demeaning and outrageous than that. She would receive no recognition because she had been born with the wrong equipment between her legs, and von Helmut hadn't.
He's quite an adept at thinking with it, too.
Daria shook her head. There was no point in being bitter about the absurd realities of the realm. It wouldn't matter in the long run whether she received her due recognition or not. What mattered was that the core, and the so-called Helmut energy it would provide for the realm, would make life better for thousands of people. She smiled at the thought, and felt far more energetic than what any cup of coffee could achieve.
All right, people, we have a world to change. Let's go.
Scientia est potentia, Nathaniel read, as Randall and he neared the village's entrance. Knowledge is power.
Aye,
Randall confirmed.
Them's words of the realm, aye?
They are a de facto motto, yes. The full thing is far longer, but the sentiment is the same. Though Castle Drachenstein was impressive and ponderous as it loomed over the skyline, the village itself was, to Nathaniel's appreciation, dreary. In the central and southern provinces of Vithernas, even the smallest houses were built out of adobe bricks and mortar. This far north, however, the houses, if they could be called that, were mostly built out of sun-dried mud and hay bricks, wooden sticks, and something which Nathaniel suspected to be cow dung. The thatched roofs above the structures looked ready to be blown away by the slightest wind, and the few larger buildings looked in dire need of repairs. Once the awe inspired by Castle Drachenstein faded away, Nathaniel took to studying the village. It was built inside a natural basin, which made its climate slightly better than the encroaching environments, as the mountainous walls, including the castle, surrounding it, warded off against the bitter northern windstorms. The disposition of the village's buildings was standard Vithernian fare. The richest, a term he used loosely, houses, were near the town plaza, and faced the two dominant structures of the village, its church and its town hall. Its single inn was erected in the western district, and was the third largest edifice after the Church of the Bright One. In the eastern quarter were various warehouses and silos, which likely housed the supply of food for the community. Other than the castle proper, Nathaniel found nothing particularly remarkable in Drachenstein, other than the ubiquitous dreariness. Nathaniel and Randall reached the entry arch of the village and stopped before going through.
This as far as I go with you, my lord. Them's military men's got to pick you.
Yeah, I get it, said Nathaniel, climbing off the cart. Thanks, Randall. Please give my greetings to your family. I'd like to give you a couple of gold coins, but you said it's worthless. The man grinned.
It's fine, my lord. It's the sentiment that counts. If yous feel like it. Our home's close to Sleater's bar, it is.
Nathaniel nodded. I may visit you. He lifted his gaze and saw a dour-faced soldier wearing full combat uniform walking towards them. As soon as I'm done with formalities.
Nathaniel?
Randall, he answered with a nod. Randall left, and Nathaniel stood at attention.
At ease,
said the new arrival as he glanced at a strange device on his left arm. You're the new guy, aren't you?
That's fairly obvious,
thought Nathaniel, looking at the man's insignia.
A corporal.
I am, sir.
Corporal Gurney. Right. Let's see, Private Nathaniel Rat...
He paused, squinted at his device, looked up at Nathaniel and back at the device.
Bright one, shiny ass, it's you! It's really you!
Nathaniel sighed. Yes, last time I checked, it's me.
The asshole who pissed his whole career away! You were major, weren't you? With top-tier gear and whatnot, and what? You gave it all away because of a few smelly rebels?
Nathaniel said nothing.
Right. Well, I'm supposed to give you a quick tour and take you to the gatehouse for due processing.
Due processing?
Gurney nodded. To assign you your Tyler and rune slate.
Nathaniel blinked rapidly.
My what and what?
The corporal lifted his arm and pointed at the device on his wrist.
A tile expressing recognition scanner. We call them tilers. They give you information on objects, things, and whatnot.
They do? Nathaniel asked. During my time, that information was relayed into the eyes through enchantments in our helmets.
Maybe down there where you have high spellcasters. Here we make do.
I see. What else can it do?
It holds your rune slate, which contains your biometrics, rank, clearances, and balance of usable hell runes. Plus a self-contained crystal set for communications, clock, logger, slate reader, he shrugged. Basically everything you Southern military...
I mean, he scoffed, former Southern military guys have in your helmet and armor. Made cheaper, made more accessible. Another shrug.
Made our way.
If you say so, sir. You mentioned usable Tauro lights? Gurney sucked on his teeth.
No one really calls them that for obvious reasons. Look.
He rummaged through his uniform's pocket and produced a small, circular piece of stone, which he held at arm's length. Nathaniel frowned at the piece. The slate-colored rock was unremarkable, except for the faintly glimmering crystalline formation at its center. At first look, he could see where the bull's likeness came from, but upon further inspection, he realized it looked more like a horned, demonic-looking skull than a bull's head.
These are physical hell runes. They're given to commoners around here. You, me, and other workers at Castle Drachenstein use our tilers instead. They have a helmet energy reservoir to...
Apologies, sir, Nathaniel interrupted. I'm afraid you're giving me too much information at a time. May we finish with the first thing you told me about before we move on to the next? The corporal stared at him and shrugged.
Hell runes have helmet energy, the energy discovered by the pointy heads at Castle Drachenstein. Don't ask for the specifics, Private. No one quite knows how it works or why, but it does, and that's what matters. It can be transmuted into many things, from food and consumables to tools, weapons, and spells.
Spells? Gurney nodded.
Are you magically attuned?
No.
Then today's your lucky day. Drachenstein has the world's most advanced contraptions born of a mix between magic and machinery. But you'll learn that soon enough. Back to your Tyler. It has a helmet energy container, as well as deposits for blue and green mana. The first one powers some weapons and spells,
The other is used to get spells or modify your weapons. Another shrug. Whatever you can afford. You seem to be implying that this helmet energy doesn't come cheap. The corporal shook his head. You're paid with it. You earn it by performing services. It all comes along eventually. Don't worry too much. You'll learn as you go. Let's move to the gatehouse now, yes? Yes, sir, Nathaniel said, and let himself be led by the corporal.
So, a device that emulates spellcasting. Interesting. Perhaps this place won't be so bad after all.
All systems are green, madam, said one of the adjutants in the core chamber.
Daria nodded.
Thank you. What are the readings on the helmet energy waves?
Optimal. There are slight sporadic fluctuations, but they correspond with a 0.005 expected variance.
Good. Containment protocols?
Ready, should they be needed, madam.
Excellent. Now we can...
Well, everything seems in order,
Erwin von Helmut's voice said, accompanied by the ever-present whistling of his steam exoskeleton.
Are the spellcasters ready for the ritual?
They are, Magus, sir,
another adjutant replied.
Capital. Let them know I shall join their incantation circle shortly. Wait, you, Erwin?
Von Helmut said nothing, and Daria scoffed.
Gods above, you can't be serious.
I am sorceress. I've reason to believe you may have ulterior motives with regards to this project. Ulterior? Bright one's ass, are you listening to yourself? I am, and I've made my choice. You'll oversee the energy readings from the control chamber. Erwin, my decision is final,
said the emaciated Magus.
I shall join the circle. Make sure to perform your duty, sorceress.
Daria glared at von Helmut as he walked slowly away.
Crippled prick.
She exhaled, turned around and said,
All right, everyone, to your positions, now.
She climbed onto the control chamber directly above the room she was in. The basaltic staircase hewn into the rocky underground, as ancient as every other chamber within and below Castle Drachenstein, felt solid under her comfortable ankle boots. Her gait was sure-footed and her countenance determined, despite von Helmut's worst efforts. The control chamber was lined with monitors, gauges, seismic readers, arcane batteries to power it all up, papers, and other implements necessary for the project. The crystal window panes, which pointed at the core chamber, were currently covered with heavy steel sheets to ward off against the helmet energy radiation emanating from the center. It had been agreed upon that arcane barriers would be erected to that same purpose in order to watch the spectacle of the core's activation. Daria turned to one of the junior spellcasters in the room and said,
Erect barriers.
Yes, sorceress, the robed man in his 30s said. He started weaving the incantation to set up a barrier, and the rest of the arcanists joined in. In moments, a translucent, shimmering field covered the crystal panes. Daria nodded, satisfied, and said,
Remove the metal sheets. Aye, madam,
an adjutant exclaimed as she activated the drawing mechanism. Steam hissed and metal grated as the enormous steel plates were drawn into their sconces, hewn into the rock, slowly revealing the central chamber. Daria stared at the core in as much awe as she did the first time around. The enormous spheroid found in the mines beneath Drachenstein hovered languidly above its dais, unfazed by gravity, vibrations, or age. It was ancient, incomprehensibly so, as evidenced by the multiple exploratory spells cast upon its surface. Thousands upon thousands of torolites, the so-called hellrunes, glowed a fierce crimson as magic was fed into them from the blue mana batteries spread throughout the room. Around the sphere stood five spellcasters engulfed in their own magic barriers, forming a pentacle pattern, with Von Helmut walking towards the center. As Von Helmut assumed his position, Daria tapped into the crystal set in the control chamber and said,
"Is everything ready?"
Her voice resonated inside the room.
"It is," came Von Helmut's confirmation. "We are ready to commence the ritual."
"Very well,"
said Daria, taking a deep breath, nodding one last time at the adjutants manning the monitoring stations and breathing out before uttering,
"Let's begin."
"Let's begin," said Gurney, sitting in front of a terminal made out of steel and brass, and with a front-facing plate made of what looked like thousands of minuscule tiles. "First, we're getting your Tyler. Please take this and put it on one of your hands."
Nathaniel nodded and took the surprisingly lightweight device. It looked like a fingerless, supple leather glove that would reach right below his elbow. On its dorsal side was a long rectangular surface. Near the elbow, the surface seemed to be composed of hundreds of minuscule metallic tiles, just like the larger terminal in front of Corporal Gurney, while at the wrist, it bore crystals and machinery alien to Nathaniel. He donned the glove and was amazed by how comfortable it felt.
"Now what?"
"Now," said Gurney, "we fill your rune slate."
"Name?"
"Huh?"
"Your name, Private, to imprint it on your rune slate."
"Right.
Nathaniel Ratkovich."
"Nathaniel Ratkovich,"
Gurney repeated, pressing the lettered keys in front of the terminal.
"Also known as the asshole who pissed away his career."
He lifted his grinning face.
"Just kidding. Age?"
25.
"Surprisingly young to be a major. Private suits you best. Sex?"
"Male."
Gurney scoffed.
"Most people say lots here."
"Right, country of origin?"
"The Thurnus, of course."
"Uh-huh.
Would you believe we've had Zaranites up here?"
"This far north?"
Gurney shrugged. "Go figure. City of birth?"
"Kadaj."
"Is that with a K or a C?"
"K."
"Right, Kadaj. Okay, come over here, please, and let me know if this information is correct."
Daniel stepped behind Gurney and whistled. The tiles on the terminal's surface had changed to reflect what the corporal had written.
"Name, Nathaniel Ratkovich. Age, 25. Sex, male. Country, Vithernus. City, Kadaj. Occupation, military. Rank, private. Clearance level, 1.
"Impressive," said Nathaniel. "I've never seen anything quite like this machine. Was it made by the wizards up here?"
Gurney nodded. "Made in-house by the pointy heads in Drachenstein. Your Tyler is practically a portable version of this one."
"So, is the information correct?"
"It is."
"Great. And
except."
A dull crimson light glowed briefly beside the terminal, and from a slot it produced a small stone. Gurney took it and offered it to Nathaniel.
"This is your rune slate. And since it's the first one that will be taken by your Tyler, it'll inexorably bind to it."
"But what if my information changes? An increase in rank, for example?"
"Don't worry about that. Your Tyler can modify information using other rune slates. Now, insert the slate in the slot right there."
"Here?"
Nathaniel asked, pointing at the slot at the base of the wrist-mounted machinery.
"That's the one."
Nathaniel did as told, easily sliding the rune slate into the Tyler. As he did so, the tiles on its rectangular surface shifted and, slowly, legible text materialized upon them. Title: Welcome to Drachenstein. Body:
Welcome, Nathaniel Ratkovich, to Drachenstein, the most picturesque village in all of Athernus. You being here can only mean one thing. You have been brought on board the most ambitious research facility in the realm. In Drachenstein, we endeavor ourselves to excellency.
developing new and better technologies for the better of all of Vithernice. From improved ways to use and harness magic, to advanced weaponry and technology, along with exciting new forms of energy, in Drachenstein, we work together for mankind. Remember, our goal is to achieve peace through superior technology, technology through superior magic, magic through superior knowledge, knowledge towards superiority. Sincerely, Mage Irvin von Helmut. P.S. Don't forget to claim your complimentary Toralite package. A small green rune at the bottom right of the device near Nathaniel's wrist began to glow. He thumbed it, and the tiles shifted immediately. Title: Complimentary Toralite Package. Body: Congratulations, Nathaniel Ratkovich. You have received 100 Toralite. Nathaniel chuckled. Well, ain't that something?
It's impressive the first time around, I'll give you that, said Gurney. The novelty wears off after you see what some of our peers use these for.
Why?
Well, let me give you a maxim about means of communication. If any medium for visual representation exists, people will find creative ways to depict the male between the legs apparatus.
Nathaniel laughed.
Hear, hear. Right. Next function of your Tyler. Do you see that dot at the front of the wrist?
Nathaniel lifted the machine and looked at it.
I do, yes. What is it? That's the optic scouter. It gives you information on certain items, such as this, he said, producing a knife within a holster. Point it at this and thumb that rune, the one shaped like an eye.
Right, there goes. He aimed the Tyler, and a dull chime sounded before the eye rune became a glow. Item, utility knife. Type, weapon, close combat. Ammo, N.A. Element, neutral. Special, N.A. SDR, F 1 to 10. Description: as basic as weapons come, this knife can cause lacerations and flesh wounds, but its usefulness as a killing implement is negligible. It's better suited to be a field tool than a proper weapon. It can be used both defensively and offensively. Useless against armor. The green rune glowed again, and after pressing it, the tiles began shifting once more. Title: Damage and Resistance. Body: Congratulations, Nathaniel Ratkovich. You have successfully scouted a weapon. Perhaps you wonder about the information relayed to you. What in the Bright One's name is this, we hear you asking. Worry not. In Drachenstein, we offer a comprehensive overview of a weapon's, or spell's, destructive capacity. Or, well, an armor's defensive potential. Standard damage / defense rating. This offers you, the user, an idea of how much fun you can have with a weapon, or how much punishment you can take with a given piece of armor. SDR qualifiers are, from lowest to highest, as follows. Fallible, 1 to 10 damage units. Execrable, 11 to 20 damage units. Disappointing, 21 to 30 damage units. Crude, 31 to 40 damage units. Balanced, 41 to 50 damage units. Awesome, 51 to 60 damage units. Superb, 61 plus damage units. But wait, what are these damage units? Answer: they're a relative measurement of the degree of physical impairment a human being can sustain without ceasing their function. Example: a rebel zaps you with a lightning spell. Oh no! After a military officer subdues your attacker, you are informed that his spell had a C-SDR. Aha, you say. This means I received between 31 and 40 damage units. You look down at your chest and see that, in fact, your skin is smoking and your limbs feel tingly. You have received 35 damage units, enough to cause some considerable wounds. But wait, that morning you had the foresight to wear an armor vest with an E-SDR. Upon further examination, you realize that your armor reduced 16 damage units from the attack. Bright One be praised, you only took a total of 19 damage units. Knowing this, you brush off the damage and carry on with your services in Drachenstein.
So, said Nathaniel, what this is telling me is that, for one, this knife is a piece of junk, and second, Drachenstein's messages are oddly and disturbingly friendly. What gives?
Gurney shrugged.
Some asshole higher up decided that a friendlier tone would be good for morale.
Was he right?
The corporal scoffed.
Sure, if you like being condescended to.
Don't worry too much about damage rating. It'll likely never come to use. But if it does, well, just remember, you absolutely do not want to find yourself at the business end of anything C or above.
Right.
Where can I get anything better than a piss-poor knife, anyways?
Well, in a tight spot, it's better than nothing.
You're a private, Ratkovich. Don't expect heavy armaments to be handed to you.
Now, let's get into the next section, shall we?
Lead the way, sir.
Gurney stood up and led Nathaniel towards a door at the far well of the gatehouse. The corporal opened the door, and Nathaniel stepped into a well-lit chamber. The wall to his right was made of crystal, overlaid with a shimmering film.
An arcane barrier, he thought, just like the ones we used at Ruthven. But there were no spellcasters around to maintain it. How is that?
He looked around him, and at the other side of the barrier, he saw two glimmering blue stones, which were set into a brass contraption and connected to receivers at either side of the barrier.
Those stones, they're using them to store and supply magic. Why doesn't the realm use this technology?
He frowned as a possible answer came to his mind.
They don't know about it.
The door in the opposite room opened, and Gurney stepped in. He sat before the magic barrier, pressed something on his tiler, and the green rune on Nathaniel's device started to glow. Title: Crystal Set. Body:
Okay, Ratkovich, it's time to test the communications on your tiler. The crystal set is, well, a crystal that uses resonance to transmit vibrations at a distance of up to 1 kilometer. A loud horn in your tiler amplifies the vibrations and turns them into voice. When the rune shaped as the profile of a speaking person glows, please press it to activate the crystal set. Also, nod once you've finished reading this, okay?
Nathaniel nodded, and Gurney returned the nod. Immediately, the rune began glowing in a dull lilac color. Nathaniel pressed his thumb against it, and after some static, a voice came through his device.
Can you hear me? Private, can you hear me?
Gurney's voice was slightly distorted, but perfectly understandable. Nathaniel nodded.
It's okay. Speak.
Hello?
There it is,
Gurney exclaimed.
The crystal set will let you send and receive short-distance transmissions. Don't expect to use it quite often. It's more likely that you go days, if not weeks, without anything coming through. Anyhow, on to the final steps of processing. Please step into the chamber behind you, so the measurements for your uniform can be taken.
Got it, said Nathaniel, as he stepped into the body-sized chamber opposite the crystal pane. As soon as he stepped in, the inside of the small chamber became lit with emerald-colored light. Only a few seconds passed, and Gurney declared,
All right, Ratkovich, step off and let the machine work.
As soon as Nathaniel stepped away from the chamber, it closed. Grinding metal and hissing steam noises came from the machine as it began producing Nathaniel's uniform. Gurney's voice came through the crystal set.
Hell runes are a wonder. Their energy can be transmuted into raw materials for stuff such as armor, weapons, and other things. That makes gear easy to maintain. At a cost, of course.
It's still quite magnificent. Makes me wonder, though. Why hasn't this technology reached the rest of the realm?
The pointy heads at Castle Drachenstein want to perfect the process before releasing it to a wider audience.
Whatever that means.
Right.
Also, Corporal, sir?
Yeah.
Why do you keep calling them pointy heads?
Have you seen those stupid hats they wear?
Yes, I have. Point taken. A metallic, artificial voice said, "Production complete."
"Well, there it is, Ratkovich. A brand new piece of armor."
Nathaniel turned around. The chamber had opened, and on its floor lay his newly shaped uniform. A breastplate, two pauldrons, a black heavy cloak, a helmet, and a shirt of chainmail. He scouted the piece with his tiler. Item: standard issue armor. Type: armor. Element: neutral. SDR: D, 11 through 20. Description: basic steel armor. Offers basic protection against slashing and blunt attacks.
"Well, at least it's made of solid metal,"
Nathaniel thought as he put the chainmail, breastplate, pauldrons, helmet, and cloak on.
"What's next?"
"The final part of processing you," answered Gurney. "Decontamination."
"Decontamination?"
"It's standard protocol in case any newcomers may carry diseases which could disturb the proceedings in Drachenstein. This is what will happen. The chamber you're in will seal from both sides. The energy barrier in front of me will grow in strength, and you'll be bathed with small doses of Helmut energy, enough to kill any lice or unwanted parasites on you."
"Sounds lovely. How long will it take?"
"A few minutes. Don't worry about it."
"Any questions?"
"No."
"Then," he said,
pressing something on the surface in front of him,
"let the process begin."
"Let the process begin,"
Erwin von Helmut declared, as he finalized the last gesture of the incantation. The other spellcasters on top of the pentacles spread their arms, releasing streams of arcane energy at one another, forming a pattern of a five-pointed star. As the pattern was finished, it coalesced upon von Helmut, who channeled the energy into the core. Daria watched attentively as the Tora lights on its surface started to glow fiercely, empowered by the magical forces injected into them.
"Yes," she thought, "this is it at last."
An alarm started blaring in the control chamber.
"Sorceress, come quickly!"
She turned around, and in two quick strides, she stood beside the adjutant. She glanced at the dials on the tile terminal in front of him and asked,
"What am I looking at?"
"Madam, the energy fluctuations recorded earlier are growing at an erratic rate, past the 5% threshold."
"Madam,"
another adjutant cried,
"we're getting anomalous energy surges from the core. Helmut energy levels are increasing beyond what we expected."
"Bright one, what is going on?"
"All right, people. I need an anti-expansion field surrounding the core as soon as—"
Daria fell sideways as a dreadful pulse emanated from the core when the tauralites forming it expanded around the room, releasing impressive amounts of Helmut energy which subsumed the central and control chambers in a deep, blood-red light. She climbed to her feet and looked through the magically protected crystal. Her eyes grew wide as she saw the nightmarish view in the central chamber. The core was open and releasing streams of crimson Helmut energy, which inundated the room around it. Only the magic wards kept those inside from being affected by the tremendous forces swirling within the chamber. How long they would hold was anyone's guess. At the center of the pentagram, von Helmut's arms were spread to their full span, and his skeletal face was twisted in a grimace of pain and terror. Daria quickly thumbed the crystal set into the core chamber.
"Cut out the spell!"
"I can't,"
von Helmut blurted out.
"Bright one! Everyone, containment measures! But, madam, those outside! Now!"
she ordered. The adjutant nodded and quickly pressed the red button on one of the terminals. As he did so, mana batteries came to life, shielding the control chamber with a near-impregnable arcane barrier. Machines were set into motion within Castle Drachenstein, sealing its gates and access ways, locking those inside indefinitely and alerting the encroaching militia forces to an emergency situation.
Seconds after the containment procedure was completed, the core erupted, releasing monstrous amounts of Helmut energy into Drachenstein. Inside the control chamber, Daria and her adjutants were violently tossed by the mammoth forces released by the ancient contraption deep within Castle Drachenstein. She hit her head, and the world became dark. Nathaniel watched with curiosity as he saw Gurney's dour expression return. The corporal was blinking rapidly as beads of sweat formed on his forehead and his upper lip.
What's gotten into him?
Immediately, the voice rune on his Tyler started glowing. He thumbed it, and Gurney's voice came through.
Radkovich, there seems to be a situation. Something's happened at Castle Drachenstein. I wouldn't worry too much. Sometimes their experiments go south. But this...
Nathaniel fell to his feet as a dreadful energy blast threw him against the chamber's wall. The blast was accompanied by a terrible rumbling that prevented him from regaining his footing. His open crystal set became alive with the noises of weapons being fired, accompanied by terrified, distraught cries.
Bright One, help us! They're...
Hold the line, you bastards! They can't just...
Ah! Please, oh Bright One, please, oh please, no! Someone! Anyone! What is going...
The rumbling ceased, and Nathaniel jumped to his feet.
Gurney! What the hell is going on? Gurney!
The man climbed to his feet slowly. His movements were twitchy and uncoordinated. He brought his hands to his head and dug his nails in until blood seeped from his scalp.
Bright One's ass, Gurney! What's happened to you? Answer me!
Gurney turned around, and Nathaniel stared horrified as his bulging, bloodshot eyes started leaking a viscous black liquid. His jaw became unhinged as his mouth opened unnaturally, and though Nathaniel couldn't hear it through the magic barrier, he knew Gurney was screaming in agony. The veins on his neck and forehead bulged monstrously until the flesh around them grew bruised before it ruptured grotesquely. Gurney reached for the crystal and left a bloody trail as his hand slid down the surface. He fell back and didn't get up again. Nathaniel was speechless. His heart beat with unnatural speed, threatening to burst out of his chest. His stomach churned at the dreadful sight of Gurney, changing into a crude mockery of humanity. He had seen plenty of death during his time in the militia. He had seen people scorched alive by magic, reduced to pulp by ballistic weapons, entrails spilled as swords and axes cut the flesh. But never something as ghastly as Gurney's fate. Unable to contain himself, Nathaniel fell to his knees and retched violently, his stomach incapable of holding the fearful bile he generated. The former major wanted to run, scream, call for help. But he could do nothing of the sort, for the decontamination process was still ongoing. All he could do was sit away from his vomit and wait.
Chapter 3. Revenant. The event at Redacted can only be described as a tragedy. Tremendous amounts of Redacted were released, affecting the populace of the encroaching village Redacted. The effects of Redacted exposure, as catalogued by Redacted, are Redacted. Released manifesto on the accident. Nathaniel stared at nothing. He felt empty and emotionless, his mind unable to accept the dreadful transformation Gurney suffered, his thoughts lingering on the same question he kept asking himself. What the hell happened? He had left the communications channel on his crystal set open, hoping to glean any information on the situation. It had grown dead silent minutes before. Decontamination complete, said the metallic voice. Steam hissed as the locks in the chamber were disengaged. Nathaniel closed his eyes and breathed deeply.
I'll find nothing here,
My only option is to go out there and see what is going on.
He opened his eyes, stood up, and stepped out of the chamber. He went towards the most immediate source of information he could think of, Gurney. Nathaniel turned to the room beside the decontamination chamber, and steeling himself for the dreadful sight which awaited him, opened the door. He was immediately met with a stench of blood and feces wafting from the distorted corpse on the floor. Nathaniel gagged, but resisted the urge to keep retching. There was nothing left inside of him anyways, and stepped further into the room. The magic batteries which fed the barrier also powered a control surface beside the crystal, but none of its controls and symbols made sense to Nathaniel. He glanced at the twisted body, its mouth open in a gaping portrait of excruciating agony.
Bright one. He was reading something on his Tyler before this happened. I wonder if I can get anything out of it.
Nathaniel knelt beside the corpse and lifted its left hand. The skin was awfully bruised and sallow. A foul, sickly, sweet stench emanated from its mouth, and a puddle which didn't bear thinking about surrounded it. He fumbled with Gurney's Tyler until he found a small button beside the rune slate slot. He pressed it, and the Tyler produced its slate. Nathaniel took the piece close to his own Tyler, and a rune shaped as a slate became a glow on his device. He frowned and pressed it, and the tile surface on his Tyler changed.
Rune tile updated. Name, Gurney Halleck Johnson. Clearance level, 2. Available notes. Hey, Gurney, you'll like this.
Followed by symbols producing a male phallus.
Happy hour at Sleeters. Newcomer to Drachenstein. Alert, priority alpha.
Nathaniel failed to find the humor in the first note, and the next two were irrelevant to him. But he opened the fourth one. Title, Alert, Priority Alpha. Body, Attention all units, Security Protocol Iota, Nu, Phi, Epsilon, Rho, Nu, Omega, activated. Martial law instated. Report to closest garrison. This is not a drill.
What the hell? Nathaniel said aloud. Martial law? Why? What's happened? Those letters. It's Grecian. Let's see. I-N-F-E-R-N-O. That's ominous, he thought, wondering what it meant.
A rustling noise behind him caught his attention. He turned on his heel and instinctively unsheathed his knife. There was nothing else in the room. He was alone with Gurney's corpse. He sheathed the knife and returned his gaze to his Tyler, frowning as he went through the other notes. The first one, as he expected, was a crude, albeit surprisingly accurate, depiction of a virile member. The second one offered no further information, but the third one gave him a glimpse at the context of his arrival. Title, Newcomer to Drachenstein. Body.
Gurney, you lucky bastard. I heard that you were tasked with babysitting the new recruit. But bright one, shiny ash, you're not going to believe who it is. I won't spoil the surprise. I'm sure you'll react just as I did, but I'll give you a hint. He's sort of an infamous legend. It's strange, isn't it? We spent months bored off our asses at the damn crotch of the world, and all of a sudden there were two interesting events. Did you hear the pointy heads are going through with some spell at the castle? I heard from Laszlo, who heard it from two of the spellcasters in one of the latrines. He was assigned cleaning duty, remember? Shit luck. Anyways, let me know what you think of your charge. I think you'll have a blast. Envious. Gloria Flatermouse. P.S. Want to go for drinks at Slater's? It's happy hour today.
Reply.
Yeah, sure. As soon as I'm done with the newcomer, and as long as you're inviting. I'm low on hell runes after our last poker game.
So, they performed a spell at Castle Drachenstein? I wonder if that has something to do with whatever's going on.
the rustling noise happened again, and he immediately turned around and called, "Who goes there?" No answer. Something clamped tightly around Nathaniel's ankle, making him yelp. Pressure grew against his boiled leather boot, and he looked at his foot. Gurney was holding him tightly. He shook the hand off and jumped backwards.
"Bright one, Gurney, you're still alive? You scared the shit out of me. Gurney, what's wrong? Are you all right?"
No answer.
"Gurney?"
Gurney emitted a low, guttural noise as he tried to stand up. His movements were spastic, uncoordinated, and unnatural. His twitching motion reminded Nathaniel of a badly handled puppet whose strings were being haphazardly pulled. Gurney finally stood up, his chin pressed against his black-stained chest. The sight made the hair on the back of Nathaniel's neck stand on end.
"Gurney, what is going on? Answer me!"
Just as before, no answer came.
"Gurney?"
he asked again, as he slowly reached for the man's shoulder. Gurney lifted his hideously deformed face, which stared sightlessly at him, its jaw dangling grotesquely open. All of a sudden, Gurney, or whatever that thing was, clamped its mouth shut against Nathaniel's forearm. Nathaniel screamed as chainmail links bit into his skin, the tremendous pressure of Gurney's mouth threatening to crush his bones. Instinctively, he used his free left hand to reach for his knife and jammed it onto the side of Gurney's throat. The revenant released Nathaniel, and black liquid seeped from the wound. The thing which had been Gurney was unfazed, however, and it slashed a clawed hand at Nathaniel's abdomen. The former major reacted instinctively, leaping backwards before the hand grabbed him. Still, it raked against its abdomen, ripping away the chainmail and the shirt underneath, exposing his gut.
"Ah!"
Burning pain shot through Nathaniel as he clutched at his wound. He took his hand away and saw that it was red. The sight, or maybe the smell, of blood seemed to excite the creature. Gurney emitted a blood-curdling shriek as it threw itself onto him. Nathaniel's instincts kicked in, and he narrowly avoided the strike. He sank his knife onto the side of the revenant, but the blade skidded against chainmail. Gurney turned again and tried to bite off Nathaniel's neck, but he ducked under the charging creature and shoved his knife into the back of its head. He twisted the knife, breaking off its blade. Gurney took one, two spastic steps forward, fell to its knees and onto its face. It twitched briefly on the floor before it went completely still. Nathaniel ran his bloodied fingers across his face, incredulous.
"Fuck!"
he screamed.
"God above, fuck!"
He kept screaming, pressing his eyes tightly shut and banging his knuckles against his helmet. Madness threatened to overwhelm him as his mind was incapable to grasp the horror he had just witnessed. A dead man came back to life and tried to... what? Eat him? Gnaw at his flesh? The situation was so absurd, so surreal, that after some time he started to laugh. His throat, hoarse from screaming, heaved spastically with manic laughter. He felt short of breath as he couldn't stop laughing. The more he stared at the two-times corpse lying on a spreading pool of foul ichor, the higher pitched and the more uncontrollable his laughter became. He couldn't believe his eyes. How could he? The dead did not, could not, come back to life. And yet Gurney had just done so. Nathaniel couldn't stop cackling madly as he fell on his haunches and began rocking back and forth. Soon, he didn't know, or cared, whether he was laughing or weeping anymore. There was no difference between one and the other. His chest ached. His stomach burnt, his throat felt raw, and his heart threatened with escaping through his throat.
"Hello,
hear me?
His eyes grew wide with panic. He looked at the corpse, expecting it to rise once more from death. Nothing happened.
Can hear me?
The distorted voice came again, and he looked down at his Tyler. The communication rune was aglow. He pressed it.
Hello? Hello? Is someone there?
A woman, he thought. Alive?
Hoarsely, he blurted out,
Hello?
Bright One's mercy, thanks. Hello? Who am I talking to? Are you outside? Are you hurt?
Who was he? I was attacked by a corpse. I saw him die.
Came and...
He closed his eyes shut and grimaced.
God damn it, Nathaniel, keep your shit together, man.
He inhaled sharply and said, This is Major Private Nathaniel Ratkovich. Who am I talking to?
Ratkovich,
the woman's voice asked.
I've never heard of you. Doesn't matter. Are you unharmed?
He shifted his position and winced. His stomach burnt and his right arm ached, but nothing was broken.
Mostly, he answered. I was attacked by... You're not going to believe it. I was attacked by a dead man.
I believe you, Private. There's been a... situation. A containment breach here at Castle Drachenstein. I need your help.
Who are you? Are you a civilian?
I am Sorceress Daria Eisenherz, one of the leaders of Project von Helmut.
Von Helmut? You mean the weird energy in the rune things?
You mean Torolites? Yes, them. You do not know?
I don't. I've just arrived. Just went through decontamination.
Decontamination? That means you are behind a powerful barrier. If so, then...
Her voice grew distorted and grainy, replaced by a crackling noise. And then a different, raspy voice akin to nails against a chalkboard uttered,
Do not listen. She's...
The voice grated against Nathaniel's already frayed nerves. More crackling, and the woman's voice returned.
Hear me, Ratkovich. Are you there?
Yes. Yes, I hear you.
Good. Listen, there's no time to explain. I must conserve energy. Tell me, what's your clearance level?
One.
One? Damn it. Is there any way you can procure a level 2 rune slate?
Nathaniel frowned and glanced down at Gurney's remains.
His slate was level 2.
I don't think that'll be a problem.
The woman sighed.
Good. Listen, the whole village is currently under lockdown. Nothing can come in or out. The only edifice open to people is the Church of the Bright One. I need you to get there ASAP, find survivors, and, if possible, a level 3 clearance. Got it?
Got it.
Good. I'll talk to you when...
Crackling.
Do not. She's... using...
Crackling.
Good luck, Nate. You'll need it. Daria out.
The communication ended. Nathaniel sighed and let his head fall against the wall.
What is going on in this damned accursed town?
He wondered uselessly. The ominous reputation of Drachenstein suddenly became a dreadful reality far beyond his worst nightmares. In the past few minutes, he had glimpsed at the bottomless, inescapable pit of utter madness as he grappled with a walking dead man.
Maybe I've gone mad, he thought. Maybe I've fallen beyond recovery. I've seen things no living human should see. And yet, I live.
He took a final breath and stood up.
And I intend to stay that way.
But how? He had no weapon other than his fists, and Gurney's rune slate to...
Gurney,
he mumbled as he gazed at the dead body. though he felt sullied and shamed at the sole thought of what he was about to do. He decided that in order to atone for the sin he was about to commit, he needed to be alive. Nathaniel knelt beside the corpse and started rummaging through its uniform. His left hand wrapped around something metallic, and his Tyler chimed. He removed a metal tube which rested upon a wooden armature. At the side of the armature, he felt a locking mechanism, and at its butt, he saw a protrusion. He pressed the locking mechanism, disengaging it, and releasing a metal case holding what looked like small metallic tubes tipped with lead spheres. Nathaniel returned the case into the butt, and the lock snapped into place. Examining the apparatus, the former major thumbed the eye-shaped rune. Item: pistol. Type: weapon, ranged. Ammo: short-caliber bullets. Element: neutral. Special: NA. SDR: D, 21 through 30. Description: a basic gunpowder sidearm. The standard short-caliber bullets it uses are efficient against flesh, but fall short against armored targets. Ammo capacity: 8 rounds per clip. Current ammo type: standard, SDR-D.
What kind of weapon is this?
Nathaniel wondered. It was unlike anything he had seen in his life. What was it that Gurney had said?
That these folks have superior technology?
He frowned.
Does this weapon work through magic, or...
There was only one way to know. The wooden armature was slightly reminiscent of a crossbow's handle, except the release lever wasn't directly below the quarrel sconce, but under the armature and surrounded by a small metallic ring. Nathaniel threaded his index finger through the ring and rested it upon the lever. The grip felt comfortable in his hand. He reached out, pulled the lever.
God damn it!
He exclaimed, as a thunderous explosion escaped the weapon. His hand was slightly thrown backwards due to the power of the blast, and his ears rang briefly afterwards. An unseen projectile must have escaped the weapon, as a hole was now carved on the opposite wall. He turned the pistol in his hand, staring at it, and reeling at the implications of such a device.
This, when the realm has this, the meaning of warfare will change forever.
He couldn't help but wonder what other, more extravagant weapons the wizards at Castle Drachenstein had created. He looked down at Gurney and further rummaged through his uniform. The pistol had been resting in a small holster, which was secured around his chest. Nathaniel removed it, too, and donned it over his armor before placing the pistol inside. He also found the hell rune Gurney had showed him and took it, in case he would need it, as well as another one of the small cases with ammunition for the pistol.
Clips, the Tyler called it,
he thought. Nathaniel looked around the room he was in, trying to find anything else that could be of use. Abandoned on the back of a chair, near the far corner of the room, he found a leather satchel.
I'm taking this in case I need to carry something. Pockets can only hold so much, after all.
He threaded the leather strap of the satchel over his shoulder opposite the pistol's holster and let it rest comfortably beside his right hip. Once it was secure, he placed the pistol's clip into it. He searched further through the room, but found nothing else that could be of use.
I'll do well in finding a backup weapon, too, just in case. A sword would be best. Almost anything other than this crappy knife. Let's see, the Tyler said 8 rounds per clip. There's a clip in the pistol, one in the satchel. That means I have 15,
He looked down at his Tyler and opened the entry regarding the pistol.
Right, bullets. So if these tiny things can do that to a wall,
he thought, glancing at the hole left in the masonry.
I wonder what they can do against flesh.
He looked down at Gurney and said, Sorry, pal, but I don't think you'll mind this too much, will you? No answer came. Didn't think so. Nathaniel unholstered the pistol, held it with both hands, and aimed its tubular end toward Gurney. He pressed the trigger, and the weapon blared again. The still unseen projectile pierced through the dead man's skull, its force enough to burst its cranium open.
"Bright One's mercy,"
Nathaniel gasped, as he witnessed the destructive potential of the weapon.
"And this is a D-tier weapon? Damn it, I wonder what a higher one can do."
Though the experiment had cost him another bullet, leaving him with a total of 14, it had been worth it. He now knew the terrifying destructive potential of Drachenstein's weaponry. Satisfied, he turned away from the room and left. The terminal Gurney had used was still functional, and Nathaniel decided to look through it in case it offered any relevant information. Error. Access denied. Required clearance, level 2. Nathaniel brought Gurney's rune slate close to the terminal, and it chimed with approval. Available notes. Registry entry. Private Nathaniel Ratkovich. Detainment manifesto. Security drill. Corrupted.
Let's see.
Title, security drill. Body.
Hello, Drachenfreund. We extend this friendly message to remind you that participation in the weekly security drills is not optional, but mandatory. We can't stress this enough. Security is of paramount importance for the proper functioning of Castle Drachenstein and its ancillary facilities, and as such, participation on weekly drills is not optional, but mandatory. We can't stress this enough. Effective immediately, failure to participate in the weekly security drills will incur a fine of 1,000 TL. Why? Because participation on weekly drills is not optional, but mandatory. We hope you understand the importance of this message. We look forward to seeing you in the next mandatory security drill. See you next time, Drachenfreund. Sincerely, Drachenfreunde Morale Brigade. Reply.
Fuck you, Drachen asshole, I...
Reply 2.
User Langley Ergendwan has incurred a fine of 5,000 TL for profane language against Castle Drachenstein personnel.
Title. Detainment Manifesto. Body. To whom it may concern. I make of your knowledge the capture of the following individuals. Olina Farshaw. Wilhelm Sawjaw Gaston. Benny Benitez. Anselm Theodore. As per requested, they are to be sent to the biological Helmut Energy Wing as soon as they are processed.
People don't seem happy with those in Drachenstein. Though it's interesting that they place so much emphasis on security drills. Almost as if they were expecting something to go awry.
He looked around the entry room, but found nothing of further interest. Satisfied, he stepped away from the terminal.
Time to leave.
He opened the door leading outside and stared aghast at the dreadful view. The sky had become a deep blood red, interspersed with bloated black clouds, which emitted zigzagging lightning as crimson as the celestial vault above. A dome-like, shimmering barrier surrounded the village, and from Castle Drachenstein, a tremendous pillar of pulsating red energy climbed beyond the clouds, losing itself in the distance. From somewhere in the village, Nathaniel could hear the terrified screams of the survivors, accompanied by inhuman guttural growls belonging to the restless dead. Or worse. Nathaniel gritted his teeth and grimaced. Armed only with his pistol and his grim resolve to stay alive, he set off into the devastated village. The Church of the Bright One beckoned. Perhaps he would find there some answers to the catastrophe which had fallen upon Drachenstein. As he walked further into the nightmare the village had become, he struggled not to let his resolve falter.
I've been through the hell of war and back again. How much worse can this be?
Chapter 4. Isolation.
There's something you need to understand and keep present at all times. Wizards are not our friends. The realm's rulers are not our friends. At best, we're all means to an end, becoming an economic, technomagical, and military hegemony. At worst, we're glorified test subjects. Olena Tirdas, in Society and Experimentation, a Critique. Nathaniel prowled through the derelict, ravaged streets of Drachenstein, tightly clutching his pistol in his hands. Every turn, every corner, every dark alley could potentially hide a deadly hazard. His already frayed nerves made him jump at every shadow, and the noises audible in the distance, inhuman growls, women and children crying, odd whispers in the dark, and other things he couldn't quite recognize, made him feel as prey stalked by a predator waiting to pounce. Reality was far worse, however. He was utterly alone. Since leaving the gatehouse, he hadn't met a single living person. Along his way, he had seen corpses, too many of them, in fact. Most were gnawed on, missing patches of skin and muscle, limbs, and at times, the entire contents of their thoracic cavities. Nathaniel was no stranger to death. He had seen his fair share during the campaigns he had participated in. He had seen gruesome deaths before, the kind that could only be caused through violent spellcasting. But even that was nothing compared to the ghastly scenes he found in Drachenstein. His journey from the gatehouse and into town had been relatively uneventful, as the distance between the edifice and Drachenstein was uninhabited. As soon as he entered town, however, the extent of the damage became dreadfully apparent. The first thing he saw as he went through another archway, which also read, "Knowledge is Power," was the lower half of the man guarding the entrance, unceremoniously discarded a few paces away from his post. Where his upper body had gone, it was anyone's guess. The second thing he noticed were signs of struggle. Splintered holes punched into the walls of a hovel, their sizes matching the damage his pistol had caused to the wall at the gatehouse.
"This means there were other survivors," he thought, feeling hopeful.
At least until he encountered the third thing. Half a dozen dead soldiers in various states of consumption, staring sightlessly at the crimson sky. Skid marks and bloody footprints told the tale of their fate. To Nathaniel's reasoning, the soldiers had holed up inside a house, finding the position more defensible. But they had been overrun by enemies coming from the encroaching alleys. He wondered whether they were attacked by things like Gurney, or by something else, especially since their armors sported deep gashes on their pieces of solid metal. Gashes which couldn't have been caused by human hands. He set off, uncertain of whether he wanted to solve that particular mystery. Now, he stalked along one of the main arteries of the city, a wide, hard-packed dirt path which he hoped led to the city center. He hadn't spent enough time in Drachenstein to know where everything was at, and there was no one he could approach with such a question. His only point of reference was Castle Drachenstein, and the shaft of pulsing, crimson energy emanating from it. A whimper nearby startled him. He quickly turned to his left, where a black alley extended into the distance. A low keening echoed from its dark length, and Nathaniel gripped his pistol tighter.
"Who's there?"
he yelled, hoping he wouldn't attract unwanted attention. Only sobs answered him. He decided to investigate on the off chance that the person, or what he hoped was a person, inside, could guide him towards the Church of the Bright One. He walked slowly, on the tip of his toes, to make as little noise as possible. The darkness in the alley was nearly absolute, as the eerie crimson sheen in the sky wasn't sufficient to fully illuminate the space. If anything, it seemed to Nathaniel that the shadows were made deeper by the unnatural light.
The low wails became louder as he reached their source. In the dim light, he saw someone resting against the wall of one of the buildings.
"Friend, who are you? Are you hurt?"
Though he couldn't distinguish the person's face, he realized the head was turned towards him.
"You,"
wheezed a male voice.
"You are alive. Not one of them."
"One of what?" asked Nathaniel.
"Those things. They're everywhere. They came from nowhere. There was an explosion. There was nothing we could do. I ran before they overran us. I heard the screams, the noises. Bright one."
"Damn it, I can't see anything. I need a light," thought Nathaniel, before asking,
"Are you hurt?"
A low, pained chuckle.
"I'm not gonna make it. Something attacked me. I didn't see what. There, oh man, there are things in the darkness. You can't see them, but they can see you."
Nathaniel knelt beside the figure and tried to hold his hand. He found none.
"Don't follow them."
The man coughed before emitting a choked gurgle and falling silent.
"Crap," Nathaniel thought. "Maybe his Tyler will have something of use. A ghastly thing to do, looting a man whose body is still warm. But any tidbit helps."
He tried to guide himself by touch, placing his hands on the body and exploring it for the Tyler, or anything else that could be of use. His fingers ran above sections which felt moist to the touch. He felt grateful that he couldn't see the state of the body. He finally found what he looked for. His fingers found the dead man's forearm, covered by the shape of his Tyler. He removed the machine and placed it in his satchel. He needed light to read anything on it, and the most illuminated area was outside the alley. When he climbed to his feet, aiming to leave the alley, Nathaniel paused to look down at his own Tyler. The crystal set was crackling violently, as if it was receiving a communication, but no rune lit up on the device. He lifted his gaze and froze. Something hovered at the end of the alley. Two glimmering dots of light visible in the darkness.
"What the hell is that?"
As he squinted into the distance, he realized that the dots of light tilted sideways, curiously. They weren't just light, but eyes, studying him from the blackness.
"Oh, crap,"
he thought, taking a slow, deliberate step back. Another step, and the dots of light tilted in the opposite direction.
"Whatever that is, I have to be careful."
Nathaniel hated not knowing what he stood against. His skin crawled as whatever those eyes belonged to tilted sideways again. The movement reminded him of common cats as they gauged whether they're interested in something or not. Nathaniel moved as slowly and calmly as he could, while keeping his own gaze trained upon whatever was staring at him. The glowing, curious eyes resumed their initial position, and a mass of blackness surged at him.
"Shit!"
Nathaniel exclaimed as he turned tail. He started running as quickly as his legs could carry him. The mouth of the alley he came in from was visible in the far distance.
"But I barely took a few steps in."
A low, hum-like noise became audible behind him, and he glanced over his shoulder. The black mass staring at him with those pinpricks of light was getting closer. He pushed as hard as he could on his feet, but no matter how fast he ran, the alley exit didn't seem to get any closer. He stumbled and fell forward. His momentum carried him forward a couple meters, and his armor and training helped him not get injured. Regardless, he quickly turned over his back to not lose sight of whatever was heading his way. It now loomed a few paces away from him and was nearing slowly, meticulously, enjoying his fear. Nathaniel gritted his teeth, took aim with his pistol, and fired. One, two, three shots into the blackness, hoping that whatever the thing was, it would topple sideways and die. Nothing happened. A horrid, distorted shriek reached his ears, and he screamed as he closed his eyes tightly shut, dreading whatever his fate would be. Seconds passed. His breathing was fast and shallow, his heart was close to bursting off his chest, and cold sweat trickled uncomfortably down his face and back. Nathaniel was terrified of the idea of opening his eyes and discovering what the creature had done to him.
"But I feel fine. I don't feel hurt or maimed. Just what happened?"
He opened his eye barely enough to see. He was out of the alley, staring at the crimson sky. Nathaniel took a deep breath to steady himself.
"What the hell?"
he mumbled as he looked at his surroundings. There was nothing around him, only the same abandoned houses and the alley mouths at either side. The sobbing had stopped, and there were no indications of the black thing which charged at him.
Was that a hallucination?
He stared down at his pistol and pressed the clip release, and after removing it, he realized that it was lighter. He had wasted 3 bullets.
Crap!
Ammunition was at a premium, and he currently had no means of defense other than the weapon.
"I have 12 left,"
he thought before rummaging through his satchel.
"At least the Tyler is in there."
He cast a final glance around him and realized he was completely alone. He stood up and walked a few paces to sit with his back against a building.
"That way, nothing will get me from behind."
And he removed the rune tile from the device.
Rune tile updated. Name, Avery Palace. Clearance level, 2. Available notes. Orders. This is boring. Pointy heads. Title, orders.
Corporal Avery, I am concerned about your recent lack of motivation at your post. One would figure that the warmth and comfort of Castle Drachenstein would be something to be appreciated, but alas, one would be mistaken. As such, perhaps you will find yourself enjoying your strolls along the town's streets while you're on patrol. If subtlety eludes you, you're now relieved from your guard post inside of the castle's observation room and are now relegated to patrol duty in town, where hopefully the cold, shit-covered streets will help you appreciate what you've lost. Have fun, Corporal. Yours truly, Sergeant Armist.
Title, This is boring. Body, short message. Screw you, Avery. Long message. Dude, come the fuck on. You get to sit your ass inside one of Castle Drachenstein's guard rooms in front of a fucking hearth eating warm food. You don't have to constantly smell unwashed peasants, filthy streets, nor horse droppings. You don't have to break up petty squabbles over whether a piece of bread is worth 10 or 20 hellrunes. And you still have the nerve to complain that you're bored? Bright one shiny ass, Avery. If you're as bored as you say, I'll gladly trade my post any day. Omar.
Original message.
Good grief, man, this is boring.
All I do is sit in the guard post with a shit-eating grin saying, "Hey, Mr. Wizard. Hey, Miss Witch," at every damn pointy head who walks by. Like, what do they expect will happen if I get up to take a piss every now and then? At least you guys on patrol get to see some action when people beat each other silly. Hell, you can even place bets on who's gonna win. Doing nothing sucks, doesn't it?
Avery. Title: Pointy Heads. Body:
Hey, Avery, have you noticed the amount of wizards coming through every day? It's like they're trying to form a small army or something. Why the fuck do they need so many damn spellcasters for, anyways?
like they saunter around like they own the world because they can go hocus-fucking-pocus and fart lightning off their asses. But they still need, like, at least a dozen of them to activate their weird machines. Makes no sense if you ask me. Anyways, if you hear anything, just tell me. Might break the monotony a little bit. Estevez.
Nathaniel tilted his head as he read the last note again. So, more spellcasters have been coming into Castle Drachenstein of late. I wonder whether that has anything to do with the spell I read about before. Still, what kind of spell would need so many people to cast?
Sir!
Wow, what the... Nathaniel yelped, as the shrill cry caught him unawares. He lowered his Tyler and stared at a child, no older than 10 years old.
Bright one's mercy, you scared me, sweetie. Who are you? Are you okay?
Sir, come with me, please, she exclaimed. I need help.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.